Shringasaurus was one of the best understood members of its group, and even within Triassic animals, it was still pretty bizarre. At about 10 feet or 3 meters in length, it was relatively lowly built, but it had a very long neck and, most significantly, supraorbital horns, which supra just means over and orbital means the eye. So there are horns over the eye. In fact, the horns of Shringasaurus have been compared to that of some ceratopsians, but it was definitely not a ceratopsian. It A, evolved long before they even show up on the scene, and B, there's some characteristics that show it wasn't even an archosaur, which includes crocodilians and dinosaurs. Instead, it was something a little bit more basal, or slightly earlier diverging. One of the most distinctive features about Shringasaurus that makes it not a crocodilian or a dinosaur is the fact that it lacks an antorbital fenestra, which is essentially an opening in the skull in front of the eye. This is most easily seen in many dinosaurs, which just have massive antorbital fenestras. Another key feature of the archosaurus is a mandibular fenestra, which is the hole in the lower jaw, which, as far as we know, Shringasaurus didn't actually have at all, so it wasn't quite an archosaur. And it also didn't have a fourth trochanter, which is a very specific muscle attachment on the femur, which helps attach a major muscle that attaches to the tail to the femur in order to help the animal move around. And it didn't have this, so it had relatively weaker tail-to-leg muscles, but that didn't mean it wasn't successful. In fact, like a lot of members of the group slightly broader than archosaurs, archosauromorpha, it had a very specific feature that would have helped it get around, and that's a calcaneal tuber. So essentially, the calcaneus, which is a specific bone at the foot, in humans it makes up the heel bone, was slightly elongated, and this would have helped it to essentially walk more upright. This would put Shringasaurus into the group Crocopoda, which means they had crocodile-like feet. And before you look at modern crocodilians, it's important to understand that they secondarily re-evolved a more sprawling stance. And that's because they're spending a lot more time in the water than animals like Shringasaurus would have. So Shringasaurus, with this ankle, would have actually been even more upright than modern-day crocodilians, which can actually still do a high walk and get around relatively well if the absolute need for it does occur. So crocodilians re-evolved their more sprawling posture because they were spending a lot more time in the water, and Shringasaurus didn't have that, so where was it living? It lived in what would become the Denwa formation of India, and this occurred during the Landian and Anisian stages of the Middle Triassic. This is the time period in which trees first really recovered from the Permian-Triassic mass extinction, in which a massive amount of life died, up to 95% in the oceans. So it was a very key point for re-evolving and recovery from this extinction. But more significantly is that during the Landian, the later stage of the Middle Triassic, that coal seams started to develop, and coal seams require massive amounts of biotic material. So things like swamp, where there's just a ton of organic material settling to the bottom in very anoxic or oxygen-poor environments in order to help form these coals later down the line. And the Denwa Formation, where Shringasaurus is found, doesn't have any coal seams, at least as far as I found. But it was starting to evolve during this time period, meaning that Shringasaurus was probably one of the first animals to start taking advantage of the regrowth of different forests and other environments. But before Shringasaurus became one of the more successful mid-sized herbivores in its specific location, there was another herbivore, and that's Lycosaurus. Lycosaurus makes up to 90% of some of the fossil beds in the Karoo Basin, where it's most populous. And so it was widely successful, including after this time period, with it evolving into many different forms. This includes animals like Placerius within the petrified forest, and then other forms, including some that were as large as an elephant, even still in the Triassic while this recovery was happening. This meant there was an opening for a mid-sized herbivore, and Shringasaurus fit the bill. With its relatively upright body and posture due to those crocodilian-like ankles, and its relatively long neck, it could reach food that other mid-sized herbivores couldn't quite reach, while still being smaller and less demanding as far as what it needed to uptake and try and eat than other larger Lycosaurus. So it became very successful in that specific niche. At least its larger group did. But the other Ascentosaurids are even more incomplete than Shringasaurus, and Shringasaurus is not very complete by any standard. In fact, even the feature it's named for, with Shringra being the ancient Sanskrit for horn, is very dimorphic between different specimens. In fact, while this entire fossil does seem to be a fairly complete fossil, this is a composite made of different individuals. And one of those individuals has the same frontal bone that the large horns appear on, except the horns on this individual are much shorter and also more narrow, meaning they probably weren't used for quite the same thing. This is one of the most identifiable cases of dimorphism in the fossil record, and it's probably sexual dimorphism, but it's going to be really, really hard to try and say which specific sex had the larger horns. And that's because even within modern-day archosaurs, including some of the birds, some of them have a lot of variability in which sex is more aggressive during the breeding season. So potentially even the females have the larger horns, or the males did. It's going to be really, really hard to actually try and tell this until we get some more complete fossils, and potentially even fossils that have a very specific type of bone, which only occurs in female animals, and that's medullary bone. And medullary bone is a special type of bone which essentially helps to store calcium to help form eggs down the line. So unless we potentially find this, which only preserves in very specialized cases, and is only around for a certain part of the animal's life, we're not going to really know which sex actually did have the larger horns. So that is a bummer, but we at least know that these animals were probably sexually dimorphic, something that's been very hard to prove in the fossil record. And the reason I bring this up is because the horns were probably used for intraspecific combat, so combat within its own species, Shringasaurus. And so this is something that's actually been really well compared in the ceratopsians, because there's been some marks on some ceratopsian skulls that do suggest that rather than trying to fight off predators with the horns, they were more likely fighting each other. And so this is actually a very good comparison, despite Shringasaurus not necessarily being a ceratopsian, because it, again, showed up long before the ceratopsians actually evolved. And while some of the later Ashendosaurids, other than Shringasaurus, may have actually lost their horns, they're still fairly partial. And so this includes animals like Ashendosaurus, which has been found in Madagascar and Morocco. And Madagascar was admittedly connected to India at the time. But coming from Morocco helps to show that they were moving westward, as do some fossils from Texas and even New Mexico, which again helps to show that they were definitely moving towards the west, and they were actually some of the first animals to start crossing the equator after the recovery of the trees. So it might seem they're somewhat important because they did eventually lose out to dinosaurs during the end Triassic extinction, they were still one of the most important factors for transitioning between the northern and southern hemisphere, and actually starting to take advantage of the regrowth of trees, making them a very important part of how Triassic ecosystems evolved.